Paltrocast. Rohit, how is your Wednesday going?
Not too bad so far. How about yourself?
No complaints here in New York. Am I getting you from Michigan or from Nashville?
Michigan, nice and cold where I'm at, freezing.
Nice always. And cold. Yes, I can only imagine that it's 20 degrees colder there. But the key is, when I first spoke with you 9-10 months ago, it was kind of like, yeah, that's the guy from Desi Hit Squad. Yeah. Now it's like, this is one of the main guys of Impact who held the belt maybe longer than anyone in 2020. I mean, when did you feel that things really turned around for you?
Yeah, it's funny. When I first won the X Division Championship belt, I knew there was a huge stigma that I had to erase and get rid of. And that was, why is this guy the X Division champion when he's been nothing but a bottom guy for his entire run? Well, you know, it's not by my choice. You know what I'm saying? So all I needed was that one shot. They gave me that one shot and I felt like they gave me the ball and I ran with it. So that's what I feel like. After Bound for Glory, or maybe leading up to that with the promos, people started to realize, oh, there's something here. There's something with this guy. And it's funny, by the end of my title reign, people were like, some people couldn't wait for me to lose it, which was fantastic. I love that. But there were some people that were like, man, I'm really getting into his run. He's such an obnoxious individual. I love it. So cool. You know, I think people started to get it. We'll see what's going to happen on the 16th. Of course, I want to regain that belt and do it all over again, but even bigger and better. That's the goal. So I don't know. We'll see what happens. But I felt like it was closer to the end of my run where people started to really realize, like, okay, there's something here.
Yeah, you just mentioned that you stepped up your game with not just getting the screen time, but delivering great promos. Also, we saw you got in the greatest shape of your life, or at least since I've been aware of you. We also saw you step up your social media game. Was there something that lit a fire under you that kind of realized that your time was now and you had to fire in all cylinders?
Well, honestly, I didn't really want to. I've always wanted to get into better shape. And to be honest, it was when the lockdowns first started happening. I had bought a half rack a long time ago. When I first got my first Impact check, I've always been into getting into shape. But that downtime allowed me to lift and eat better every single day. So I got into better shape, which was really good. And then I used to love to like day drink and hang out and stuff like that. And I just kind of cut out a lot of that. So it helped me get into better shape that way as well. I still like to hang out and have fun, but I just don't do it as much. You really can't nowadays with everything being, you know, closed or whatever. But now my main goal is just staying in the shape. I go to the gym every single day. I'll be going to the gym after this. I try to eat a lot better. I want to be in great shape for the 16th. My social media game, I really had, besides like doing Hakeem Zayn stuff, there was no urge for me to do anything as Rohit. I was just trying to toe the company line and stay relevant. I think as soon as I got my chance and my shot, I wanted to step up my game. I always wanted to do it, but there really was no point because I wasn't going anywhere. As soon as I started to go somewhere, I was like, okay, now's the time to turn up the flame a little bit and show why I am in this position. And I felt like I picked a good time to do it. And nobody was doing that stuff with the belt, hanging out with the belt, posting all those pics. I had that idea long ago. I was like, man, if I ever get a belt, this is what I want to do. And I felt people started to catch on to that. It made me feel really good.
Was it a struggle for you? And if struggle is the wrong word here, please help me find a better word. But was it a struggle for you to know that you're a funny, charismatic guy, but kind of have to be held back to having a mouthpiece like you did in the past?
Frustrating is what it was. Now, don't get me wrong. Working with Gama is a 10 because I love Gama. Right. I love just listening to his stories and stuff like that. But there was a point in time where I was like, I don't see this ever ending for me. I feel like this is always going to be my position. And I wasn't happy. You know what I mean? I was like, man, I don't know. But it doesn't stop you from working hard. It doesn't, at least me, it doesn't stop me from working hard and wanting to always put my best foot forward. It just gets frustrating because you know your worth in a sense. Mm-hmm. And you weren't, and you know what you can offer and what you can do, but you weren't getting those opportunities. And I always say this in every interview that I do, I was always a lion in a cage, butting his head against the door. Impact Wrestling just opened up the door and I flew out and I just sprinted and I never looked back, and I'm not going to look back. I don't ever want to go back into that position where I'm that bottom of the barrel individual. And I feel like I have proven myself and established myself in that sense to where I can be one of those guys the company can count on to deliver, whether it's a great promo, whether it's a good match, to be entertaining. I feel like I can be that individual.
And besides you, Impact has also been firing on all cylinders. There was all the big signings around Slammiversary. Now we're seeing lots and lots of special events. And of course, the growth that came with Access TV, Hard to Kill. In other words, it seems like every week of Impact is practically a special week now. When did you start to notice that Impact was not just a company, but maybe the company for a lot of people?
I felt like we were long before Slammiversary. We just needed eyes on us. Our roster, super talented. It's always been talented. I felt like when I got there, when I had my first shot in 2017, it was under different management. And I was like, there's some stuff, like, you can see why people aren't very high on the product. But then things changed and it started to get better and it started to get even better. And then certain people left and other people came in. And then you had a roster that was hungry. You had a roster that wanted to do nothing but make a name for themselves, but also show that, hey, we're a good company. And I felt like Slammiversary helped finally get some eyes on us. The AEW crossover helped get some eyes on us. But I felt we have been doing really well as a company for a long time. And people always need somebody to kick. They always need someone to complain about. And for whatever reason,
right,
that don't even watch the product, you're like, oh, Impact Wrestling's dumb. You know, it's just this stupid, right. It irks me so much, like today's society with how they act with certain things. But like, they don't even watch the product and they try to act like they know what's going on. Like, no, our roster's killing it. When some of our guys go to different promotions, they excel there. They were still excelling here. It's just because they're good. And they were, you know, toying along the company as well and promoting the name. People just weren't paying attention. Now that I feel like they, if they actually pay attention, sit down, shut up, and pay attention to the product and come with an empty glass, they're going to be like, oh, yeah, these guys are rocking and rolling. And that's all we need. All we need is the opportunity. And I feel like we're getting that now and we're starting to open up some eyes. And it feels good. It honestly does.
Right. And it's probably been about 9-10 months now that you've been regularly going to Nashville. I can't imagine you've spent this much time in Nashville in your whole life combined up until now. Do you have a favorite restaurant or two that you can recommend out there?
Hattie B's, boy, every single time. I mean, if we're there for 3 or 4 days, almost every day we're ordering Hattie B's after the tapings. Man, that chicken is so good. Some of the best chicken I've ever had. Hattie B's, if you get this, free meal for the Impact roster next time, because we're constantly supporting you guys, constantly blowing up your name. I think it's time, you know, to give back a little bit, Hattie B's, and hook up the Impact roster, because trust us, we will be very appreciative of that. We're going to buy it either way, but a nice little, maybe a gift card or something, you know, a nice little rub there for some of that chicken. It'd be excellent. But Hattie B's is the place for the majority of us.
I will tag them in the social media. You got time for 3 quick fire, rapid fire questions, and then you're a free man and getting to the gym?
Sure, let's go.
First one, you are one of the most synonymous wrestlers with gaming in general. Is Cyberpunk 2077 overrated or as good as you expected it would be?
I have yet to play it because I wait for them to get out most of the glitches, because I will lose my mind if I try to play this game and it crashes over and over and over again. So even though I have a PS4 Pro, I heard it runs a little bit better on that. I'm still going to wait probably until March to pick it up. And then I'll let you know. I'll let you know next time we do the, if we do another article thing, I'll let you know how that is, because yeah, man, I want to play Cyberpunk. I just finished Kingdom Hearts 3, which was really a letdown. Oh, it was so rough to get through. But Cyberpunk, I'm hoping will be my next purchase, but they got to clean it up. They have to clean it up a little bit more before I'm going to spend that money on it.
It's great on Stadia. I have to say that. Question two, favorite TV show of the moment, because, you know, everyone gets through their shows in 2-3 weeks and then they got the next one.
Mandalorian season two was some of the best Star Wars I've ever watched. Obviously, I'm a huge, huge Star Wars fan. Spoiler, if you haven't seen it, so pause this right now. When Luke Skywalker is one of my favorite characters, I absolutely hated what they did to him in The Last Jedi. I was not a fan of the sequel trilogy. But Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni, what they're doing right now with the Star Wars lore and respecting the hardcore fans, oh, man. I have done nothing but watch reaction videos almost every day just to relive that moment through somebody else. And yeah, season two of Mando, especially that finale, was fantastic. And I just finished Cobra Kai season three, which was also great. And that's how you run it, man. If you have a nostalgia show, a show built off of nostalgia, that's how you do it. Cobra Kai is the perfect example. You take those old characters, you show what has happened with them, but you obviously respect them. And you take care of their characters, but you also pass the torch. There's so many of these new franchises that Hollywood takes, and they just want to kill off everything or disrespect everything that was brought before it and be like, oh, look, these characters are better than the old ones. No, they're not. There's a reason why people love these old characters, because they earn that respect. They earn that love. You can't just shove somebody else in our face and be like, shiny new toy. No, there's things you have to respect and earn, and Cobra Kai does that perfectly. Whereas a lot of these other franchises that have come out in the past few years have not, and they've really ruined the franchise and then get mad at fans when they don't like it because you ruin their favorite characters. It blows my mind. But those are my top two right now.
You just answered my third question, which was going to be Cobra Kai related. So instead I'll say, since our first interview, has Rohit Raju listened to the Judgment Night soundtrack?
Oh, I have not. I have been slacking. Sure. I forget things all the time. I will send me a message and remind me, because I will forget. I will. But I that will be on my thing when I'm working out or something like that. I will put that on the playlist and we'll go from there. But you have to remind me, because I'll walk in the next room and I'll forget what I was going to do. So
the bottom line is this. Thank you for your time. Keep up the greatness. Looking forward to seeing what's happening at Hard to Kill. Everything beyond that. Have a great 2021.
Thanks, man. You too. Paltrocast.